show you my trick to cooking salmon perfectly in the oven every time. I've recreated a recipe that is dairy-free and grain-free, all made in one pot. It's my happy enchilada dance. So excited that you and your families are here tonight to join me and my family as we start cooking to Christmas. This has been a crazy year. No one could have imagined where we would be a year ago, especially not me. I know for me, I'm super thankful. I'm thankful to be healthy and at home with my family for Christmas this year. 2020 has been a hard year for everyone. So I want you guys to settle in for a fun night, a night of family Christmas traditions, cooking, laughter, music, and even a couple of special guests that you won't want to miss. So come on into our home and into my kitchen, and let's have a fun night cooking to Christmas.
Great.
Hey guys, thank you so much for being here. Ryan was just getting counted down and he said he feels like it's a lunar launch.
I feel like Elon Musk.
But really, we have been planning this for so long and we're just so excited that you guys would choose to spend your night here with us tonight. So this actually started when I was on tour last year. And if you don't know this about me, I love the holidays and I love anything to celebrate. And so while we were out and I was meeting all of you guys, I just dreamt up this really fun celebrations tour where I was going to go and meet all of you and you would be sitting at long tables dining on all of the Thanksgiving food from celebrations and we would sing carols and we would decorate Christmas trees and make wreaths. And it was this grandiose, really, really festive plan. This year is a little different. And so as we started getting later and later into the year and realizing that meeting you guys and being with you in person wasn't going to happen, we dreamt this up and we went digital. I just almost started singing an NSYNC song, but I won't do it.
You can. You're live.
And so we're just really excited to have the opportunity to be with you guys tonight and to be able to have a little slice of holiday spirit.
Spread some holiday cheer.
And spread some holiday cheer, singing loud for all to hear. So we're going to have a bunch of fun stuff tonight, but we are going to get started making dairy-free eggnog that comes from my celebrations book. Y'all got the recipe in advance, so if you want to make it with us, we would love to have you do that, but you can also make it afterwards. And I might spike Ryan's, which is absolutely acceptable if you want to do a little splash of some brandy or some rum. So we're going to get started. And then we're going to bring Asher in while this simmers for a minute. And he is going to play a very fun game with us. So we're starting with the eggnog.
Cool.
I don't need you too much for this part, except for I need you to grab my 6 whole cloves. I have a can of full fat coconut. So
Wait, what do I do with the 6 whole cloves?
We're going to drop them in there.
do I grab them now?
Yeah.
Okay.
You need very, very step-by-step instructions, don't you?
Well, you're like, hey, just grab them. Yes. There's multiple things in this bowl. I just want to make sure I do the right thing.
So when I say full fat coconut milk, we're talking the can, not light, not the carton that has a bunch of things in it that keep it shelf stable and keep it liquidy. What you really want is this really nice coconut milk fat on the top and then all of the water underneath. So make sure that you get all of that. You can warm your can first and shake it up so that it's all incorporated. But because we're putting it on the stove here, it doesn't really matter. All right. So go ahead and drop those.
You just opened that straight away. And you didn't do anything to it, right? You didn't skim anything off.
No. Most of the time, the fat's going to gather at the top. I mean, unless you have very, very hot weather, which none of us really have. Well, not none of us, actually. There were 2 people that tuned in from Japan last night.
I was going to say the Southern Hemisphere.
And the UK. And I know there's a lot of Australians who love to use my books.
Stop being so Northern Hemisphere centric.
Okay, fine. All that to say, all of our lights just went on. Uh-huh. You want to turn those off while I do that?
Yeah.
So we don't have shadows. Ryan is Mr. Automation. And so things go on automatically all the time.
Yes.
Sometimes they're great. And it's a great energy saver, but sometimes...
But when you're live, that is awesome.
Yeah, or when we did that podcast recording together in our closet because it was too loud. It was like the beginning of the pandemic. All the kids were here and it was crazy and we were trying to do a podcast together. So we went into our master closet and the light just kept turning off because it turns off after there's like no motion for 30 seconds.
Are you just stirring it?
No, I'm stirring it right now. Okay, so we're going to turn this on And I always joke about these things. These induction burners are really great for things like this, but your temperature levels are like numerical. So 800, 1000, 1200. I don't really know what medium is, but we want to be about medium. We're going to let this just warm up for about 3 to 5 minutes. And with that, we've got our oldest here. So we thought it would be fun to play a game of Christmas movie trivia. So I love Christmas movies. You guys probably know this about me. We just published actually my ultimate Christmas movie guide for adults and kids. From Thanksgiving until New Year's, I try to cram in as many Christmas movies, Christmas TV specials, Christmas cartoons, even the special episodes of like the normal Disney shows that the kids watch, Christmas themed. And I am known to quote Christmas movies typically like all year round because I can't really quote any other movies.
It's true.
So we're going to play against each other, have a friendly game of Christmas trivia.
Friendly. You know, Ryan, in this house is not friendly.
I'm a little competitive.
A little.
Ryan hasn't played Monopoly with me since we were newlyweds.
It's been like a decade.
So to be fair, I have not looked at this list. It has been developed without me and printed, and Asher got to get it off the printer. It is top secret. So he's going to read a quote. We are going to try to guess what movie it's from. And then bonus points if you know the character's name.
What about the actor or actress?
Says it. Oh, gosh. Okay.
Like double bonus if you
know the actor. I know. We'll figure that out. It's okay. Asher's like, there's no key for that. I think between us, you guys in the comments, I think we should be good to know which one's which. We would love if you guys are hanging out in the comments while you're watching this for you guys to play with us.
Yeah.
Play with your families if you're at home watching it. If you're on Zoom with your friends, play with them. Keep a tally. It's just a fun game. And then we can all share our scores at the end. You ready?
I'm ready.
Let's give Ryan the first question.
No, I was going to say ladies go first.
Oh, well, that's very kind. I was going to try to give you an advantage.
Yeah, I was going to say, because then when I beat you, you'd be like, oh, because I gave you an advantage.
Okay. All right. Go for it, bud.
First question is, seeing isn't believing. Believing is seeing.
Is this for me or for
your
dad?
That's for you.
For you.
Believing is seeing. It's from, it's from this. Is it from Santa Claus?
Correct.
Correct. And who says it? It's Charlie that says it. I'm pretty sure. So Asher doesn't have the answers for who it is. So if y'all are in the comments, tell us if I'm correct. But I feel like, or it's somebody in the North Pole.
No, you can't have multiple answers.
No, I know. I might be wrong. I'm not going to get the bonus points for this because I don't know if it's Charlie or if it's somebody. I can hear it in my head. I can't tell if it's somebody in the North Pole. I'm going to turn this down because
I think I know who it is.
Who?
Santa Claus? Or
this? You think Santa Claus says it?
Tim Allen
yeah. in the movie. You might be right. You might be right. I feel like I hear it as a little kid's voice in my head. And Charlie in the first one is little, and his little voice is so cute.
See, I don't think it's either of those.
Do you think it's Bernard?
Bernard.
Might be Bernard.
I think it's Bernard. All right, we got to keep moving on this.
Dad,
right?
Keep moving.
Okay. Go ahead. You are a sad, strange little man.
Oh. You are a sad, strange little man.
Will Ferrell playing Elf. In the conference room of Conway Publishing, towards minute 150.
You're going all in on this. Wrong.
No.
Wrong. Oh,
that was way off.
You doubled down.
Yeah,
you,
I did.
You were all in.
Was it?
You are a sad, strange little man. Say it in Buzz Lightyear's voice.
Is Tim Allen?
Yeah, it's Santa Claus.
No.
Three. Two.
Yeah.
It's Santa Claus 2. All right. This is really quick, Asher. You'll read the next one, but I'm going to give everybody the next instruction really quickly. So I have 3 egg yolks here. If you're allergic to eggs, you do not have to make eggnog with egg yolks. It definitely gives it that custardy flavor, but you can just leave them out, especially if you're using the full fat coconut milk and your homemade cashew milk, because it'll thicken it really nicely. So we have our maple syrup. Can you grate some nutmeg for me? We need about...
How do I grate nutmeg?
You just grate it like you would Parmesan cheese. So freshly grated nutmeg, if you haven't done it, is amazing.
How much?
I'll tell you when to stop. But
do I need the cider?
Yeah, any of it. It doesn't matter. Okay. It just makes... I mean, see that? And if you smell it, it smells so good. If you can get... I mean, you can get them anywhere, but freshly grated nutmeg. Amazing. That's good. That's good.
That's it?
Yeah, that's it. Okay. All right, we have vanilla.
Wait, what did you put in before? Molasses?
Yeah, maple syrup.
Maple syrup.
Maple syrup. And then some cinnamon. And then you have to temper your egg yolks. So that always sounds more intimidating than it is. But essentially what you need to do is just introduce them to some heat before you put them back on the stove, or you'll make scrambled eggs. So what we do is we heat the milk first. We pour a bit into the egg yolks so that they get used to the idea of being warmed up, and then we put them back on the stove. So I'm going to have you stir. You don't have to whisk like vigorously. You just need to whisk. Oh. And I'll pour this in. Great. Nicely done.
Stop beeping.
It just goes, it's because when I pull it off, it's fine. Okay. All right, so go ahead and put that back in.
Back in where?
Back in the pot, sorry. Ryan definitely checks me when I'm like being too quick in my instructions. It's actually really helpful when I write directions and instructions for you guys in cookbooks, because I just say, go ahead and put it back in. He's like, put it back in where?
I have no idea what I'm doing.
All right, so we're just going to let this go over low heat. I'm going to stir it every once in a while just so we don't scorch the bottom and it doesn't get kind of chunky at the bottom. But otherwise, that's it until we mix in our cold cashew milk. So let's go again.
Oh, okay. No.
Let's see. What's the score?
So what's the score?
1-0. Wow.
So it's mom. How can you stop an angry dog from biting you on Monday?
How can you stop an angry dog from biting you on Monday? I have to be honest, that one does not sound familiar, but only I'm going to guess a Christmas story because of the dogs.
Yeah.
What is it?
It's White Christmas.
It's the song.
Why don't you take a moment? Why don't you take a moment for yourself outside?
Oh my gosh, I'm really sad. That's my favorite movie.
I'm very sad for you.
It's that's part of the song. That's why not. Can right? It's part of the song. Quotes. These are hard.
Oh gosh, here we go.
My confidence level just dropped. Sank.
Yeah,
I can sing. I can hear him singing the song in my head. Okay. Wait, hold on. How can you stop an angry dog from biting you on Monday? Give something to the dog on Sunday. It's a joke. It's when they're doing the.
You can't make up for it. You're not getting points. You're not getting like extra credit for the problem you missed.
I know. Fine. Okay, Dad, go ahead. You're torn.
Hey, this one you're probably going to get. I don't know, Scott. You're as healthy as a horse. So what?
Oh.
You put in on a little weight.
Santa Claus won.
Yeah.
Yep.
Boom! And it's the doctor talking to Scott.
That's correct. Ding, ding, ding!
One to one.
Beating mom.
He's beating me?
He didn't put extra points because...
That's right, because you didn't get the thing.
I've been talking a big game this week, you guys.
Seriously.
Like, a big game. I've been telling him that he's going to lose. All right, son.
Okay, wait.
Give me a good one.
So, it is...
Do your mom.
Do your worst.
Wait a minute. I got it. How about this? The Molinator.
Oh, yeah. That's from Santa Claus 2. And it is the Tooth Fairy, I think.
Yep.
I mean, it's about the Tooth Fairy. I can't remember if he says it or if that's somebody else.
Oh, it might be Santa Claus
or it might be the Tooth Fairy.
Maybe we should just get rid of who's saying
yeah,
it.
Yeah,
no
fine.
Checking you.
Okay, fine.
I feel like you're going to add extra points and I'm not going to know. You'd be like, I totally got that one right. And you'd be like, I won. They
okay, no more of that. No more of that. Okay.
All right. Go on to the next one.
Okay.
So it's Dad.
I'm ready.
There's no Christmas in the Army, Captain.
That is White Christmas.
Yes.
Which is not well.
Oh, stop. Okay. Don't go there.
They can talk about that later.
I was going to say, they can all hear your thoughts on White Christmas later.
Yeah.
All right. Go ahead,
buddy. Okay, Mom.
Yep.
This one y'all know too.
Okay.
Is this toothbrush approved by the American Dental Association?
Yeah. Home Alone 1. Yeah. And it's Kevin. I know we're not doing that anymore.
Yeah.
But all right.
Okay. Daddy. They're gathering at the center of the city. That is where Santa will give the first gifts of Christmas.
They're gathering at the center of the city.
Oh, I know that one.
Oh,
Polar Express.
Yes.
Yep.
I was going to give you a clue and be like, you got it.
Yeah, that was hard.
I think
that
said you wanted.
That was super hard.
If it's a Christmas, give it away.
That's true.
Really?
Yep. Yeah.
Yeah, I agree.
Wow, you guys are way cooler than I am.
I just hope that there's not It's a Wonderful Life on here anywhere, because I don't watch it. And I
think it's a wonderful
I mean, the only one I know is that the angel gets his wings, because everybody knows that. Okay, go ahead.
You can mess with a lot of things, but you can't mess with kids on Christmas.
Oh, I know that.
It's Home Alone.
Yes.
Yeah, it's Home Alone. But it's 2, Home Alone 2. because of the toy store in the hospital.
Yes.
Yep.
You almost got that wrong.
No, I didn't.
Yes, you did.
You're no, like,
it's Home Alone. It's Home Alone.
I just had to think about it for a second.
Okay. So that was
actually, where are we at?
Score too.
Yeah, like he's that. Keeping score. Where are we at? Are we tied?
Yeah, we're tied.
All right, read this next one, and then I'm going to move on to our next step of our eggnog.
It is Merry Christmas, you filthy animal.
Oh, well, wait. Oh, so now I feel like this might be a trick question.
It is. You know why?
Because it's in multiple movies.
It's in both.
Well, there's actually more than just two.
I don't watch the third and the fourth.
I think you should expand your horizons.
Nope.
We watched it's still one. Labeled Home Alone.
Oh, it's for Dad.
So Home Alone, one and two.
Yeah. You said Merry Christmas, you filthy animal, right?
Yeah, it was only in one, but should I give him credit?
He watches that. No, actually, you know, it only might only be in one because he watches the sequel in two.
But doesn't he say it, though?
Or you were smooching with Mo. I think it might be just one, but you're okay. Good. You're good. I think you get a point. You get a point.
Point.
All right, how many more do we have left? One each?
Wait, let me sure. This isn't good. You have... Yeah, one each.
One each. All right. Ooh. Let's go. Let's
Wait,
go.
Oh, is it?
I'm going to turn off my burner, you guys. So if you're making this with us live,
yes.
We don't make normally sure we play. I was going to say, yeah. We normally don't play Christmas trivia while we make eggnog. We don't want to burn it.
Okay. So, Mom, this box is meowing.
Wait, say that again?
Mom, this box is meowing.
Oh, Christmas vacation.
I could have gotten that one.
Wait, that one? I didn't know it.
That's because you haven't seen it.
You haven't seen it. You will soon.
You'll see it maybe in a couple of years. Christmas Vacation, one of our favorites.
Right? That is right.
Yes. Okay.
She wraps up her cat, Russ.
And then Daddy.
Oh, man. I wish I got the Christmas Vacation one.
You might get one. You never know.
Get down on your knees and tell me you loved me.
Get That's down Home on Alone your knees 2. And tell me you love me.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Switching with everybody.
I love you.
That's the end.
That's the end?
That's so, it?
What is it?
Dad.
I won?
Yeah.
I love you.
I can't even believe it. I might have to just like brush. I might have to have a Christmas movie.
Yeah, I may need to take you to school.
Asher, did you and your dad like Christmas plan movies. That ahead of time?
He might have got an extra allowance for that.
All right.
Good job, Asher. All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Asher.
Let's turn off your mic.
Yeah, we'll see you in a minute, bud. Okay. So, you know what? I'm going to grab this because I would try to put this in here, and knowing me, it would get everywhere. So we're going to go like this. This is just a canning funnel, by the way. If you're ever trying to pour liquids into any sort of a bottle, just do this. So I leave the cloves in while it cools in the fridge because they just add so much flavor to it. You are going to want to strain those out before you serve that. They're not exactly nice to crunch down on. Would you put that over in the sink for me, my love? Thank you. Okay, and then homemade cashew milk is great. You know what? I think the instructions probably tell you to put the cashew milk on the stove and heat it because it actually helps to thicken this. We weren't paying much attention. Either way, it doesn't really matter. As long as your egg yolks get cooked like they did, it does not matter. But if you do homemade cashew milk and you put it on the stove, as it heats, it's actually going to thicken even more because when you make it homemade, you don't strain out the cashews. And as they heat, they actually get really nice and silky and kind of thick. So you do want to refrigerate that. You know, I mean, it tastes fine warm, but it kind of tastes like the pudding before you refrigerate it. So definitely put it in the refrigerator and the flavors get better as it sits. For like a day or two. We, however, have some already made. So if you want to grab that, yep, right there. and as we start to sip on this, put your eggnog in the fridge. If you want to enjoy it right away, here's a quick tip for you to chill it even faster. Yeah, that one's yours. Put a big, huge bowl with water and ice. And then put your freshly made eggnog right in it and mix it around every couple minutes. It'll chill a lot faster than having to put it in the fridge. And maybe you can just enjoy a little bit with us as well. So cheers.
Cheers to me.
Poured a little something in there for you.
To me winning.
Whatever.
You should have loosened up with this maybe beforehand. You would have been.
Maybe I should have. I didn't get any wrong. Is it because you got bonus points and I didn't?
I don't know.
So unfair. Okay. I think if it wasn't for me, you wouldn't have even seen all of those Christmas movies. You
That's probably true, but sometimes the master gets taught by the mentee, which I totally mixed metaphors.
Yeah, right, you did. Yeah. Okay, guys, so we asked you guys a couple of weeks ago to send in questions that were all Christmas related. So Ryan and I sat down and we answered a bunch of those for you guys, and we brought you into our house and with our kids and talked all about our favorite Christmas traditions and why they mean so much to us. So that is next. We hope you guys enjoy it.
We had a lot of people send questions in. We are just going to tell you guys about what we do as a family and all of the different traditions that we do, where they came from, what we love. And so I'll start. Ryan, what is your favorite holiday tradition that you remember as a child first?
It would be hiding the pickle.
Hiding the pickle.
So every year my parents would hide a pickle. Actually, it didn't start with my parents. We got the pickle given to us by someone, and my parents hid the pickle. And if I found the pickle, I would get a present.
So when we first got married, he mentioned something about this pickle and hiding it in a tree. And I had never heard that in my life ever. And so of course my first, you know, like images of that are like you actually put a dill pickle into the tree. I know that sounds crazy, but I was like, maybe it's some weird tradition where you find it and you eat it. And so he explained it to me and we got a little glittery green pickle from his parents, I'm pretty sure, our very first year as a married couple. And when you found it, were you got to open a present? Mm-hmm. Okay, so in terms of the rest of our traditions, I would venture to say that 90% of them come from my upbringing, because I have a mother who is more than fanatic about Christmas than I am. Everything from our throw pillows to our throw blankets to the flags hanging outside to the dishes to the mugs. I mean, everything in my childhood was swapped out for Christmas. And it was always the day after Thanksgiving. That's when we decorated, which we've adopted. We do the day after Thanksgiving, except for this year, because it's 2020. And right after Halloween, I just said, you know what? We're doing it this year.
And we did it in April.
We did it in April. We did a quarantine Christmas to keep our kids just like happy and entertained when we first got locked down, and it was really sweet. I mean, it was much more small scale. We didn't really decorate. We just put up a fake tree. That was it.
Just a fake tree.
No ornaments, just lights. But so, Ryan, how do you feel about listening to Christmas music?
It's awful. Generally. No, I'm just kidding.
Oh, I was like, you can't blink and say that. How do you feel about listening to Christmas music before Thanksgiving? Why don't you tell the people how you feel about that?
It shouldn't be done. I mean, it ruins it.
Yeah.
And I think the waiting for the Christmas music is the most important part. You don't listen to it, and then you get to listen to it, and then it's all the more special.
Right. So, but this year, I said, I don't care what you think. In a nice, very nice way.
Just this year.
I just was like, you know what? Halloween was over and I just was feeling the need for something happy and joyful. Mm-hmm. And yeah. So we've been listening to Christmas music. We put up our decorations, not all of them. We still have to go get our tree, our real tree. But we have enjoyed it and it's made our house just feel happy and light and beautiful. And I love it. What else? We have our Christmas village, Ryan's favorite thing to put up.
I love it.
Every year. So we had them growing up in my Department 56. My parents collected them, my mom specifically, and we would go as kids in our joint gift where we would like save up our money and my dad would go take us to pick one out. We would pick out a new, either like a house or a shop or little people for her village. And I had such good memories of that. So when we got married, it was one thing that I really wanted to start. And Ryan bought me one when we got engaged, so that's written on the bottom. And then we actually found out that your grandpa had some. Mm-hmm.
What other traditions do you have?
Oh, so many. It's like I'm gonna have to try to whittle it down. Yes, so many. You know that? Okay, let me run through them quickly. But of course, baking. We bake all the time. My sister and my mom and I used to bake, and that was what we would give out as gifts, homemade just cookies and fudge. And so I do that kind of all season long with the kids, cut out cookies with frosting and decorating and marshmallows and hot cocoa and fudge. And it's, there's usually something like every day. All the Christmas movies. that you could imagine, definitely. And then I think probably one of the most special things that we adopted after our daughter Ayla passed away was we still hang her stocking. And when Asher was young, he, you know, just in terms of trying to process and figuring it out and seeing her name up there and kind of, you know, what we could do, one of the things that we wanted to do to honor her was that we would go shopping every year and pick out a bunch of toys for a girl that would be the age that she would be. And we would donate them over at the PICU at our hospital, our local hospital. Last year, something new that we did because I was sick, and then I think we're doing it again this year just because of the pandemic and things being so different, is that we started sponsoring a little girl through Compassion. Her name's Adisa, and she's from Uganda, and she has the exact same birthday, June 24th, 2014, as Ayla, and so it's really sweet. The kids draw pictures for her, and they write her letters, and they connect with her in that way, and they really see how fortunate they are, which I think is a great gift for your kids, especially around the holidays. And so we sponsor her every month, as it's been a year now, and then we're going to pick another little girl together as a family that has the same birthday this Christmas. And that's kind of our new tradition, and I love it. It's new, and I really love doing it. And then the last thing, I guess, and there's so many more, but the last thing that I particularly love are the books. So I started collecting Christmas books just after Asher was born, so for the last 10 years. So we have quite a collection, and I pack them up every year with the Christmas decorations so that they kind of like remain special. And we usually pull one out every night leading up to Christmas. And this year, it's going to be like 2 months worth of Christmas books I may have to buy. Well, do we have enough?
Probably.
Okay. It's really sweet and special. I used to wrap them up like 12 days of Christmas and let them unwrap one every night. And then I realized that that was a huge waste of paper and time, and I just couldn't do it anymore. So now I just keep them hidden, and I pull one out every night. Do you remember opening any gifts that you were super disappointed about?
Yeah.
All right.
I told you that story.
I want to hear it again.
You want to hear it again? Okay. So I really wanted a BB gun, as any probably pre-teenager would want one.
You'll shoot your eye.
And it literally was that. I mean, it was literally, so it was, I'll date myself with this, but with the story, but there was a big, long, skinny present next to the tree. And it was the perfect shape for a BB gun. I was so excited to open that BB gun. And so I left it for last. And so I literally opened up all my presents, and I could see my parents looking at me going, why are you leaving that one for last? I was young, so obviously I didn't pick up on that, but it ended up being that I opened up this big, long box expecting a nice, beautiful BB gun, and it was a CD tower to hold my CDs. It was CD. Plastic.
For all you kids watching, I'm like, who grew up on iPods and CDs.
Smaller than a record.
And they usually, I feel like a lot of times they were kind of like, was yours just straight up and down like a tower?
Slide it in.
And you just slide them all in. I worked at Pottery Barn while we were dating. And I was the kind of person that like would tear out the catalog pages, and I kept them in a binder. And I had this grand vision of like what our household would look like as a newlywed couple. With kids.
Just the furniture portion.
Yeah, in everything.
I know.
I always told Ryan, I was like, we're not putting homemade ornaments on the tree. I want it to be all uniform. I want everything to like have, you know, the same look and the same color scheme, and I wanted it to be symmetrical. And I mean, that went out the window so quickly after our first child, but especially now with three, because they all have so much meaning to them, and I love them. I do have another tree that I keep very simple. It's mom's tree, but I love letting them hang them, and I love bringing them out every year and seeing like what they made the year before, and they remember it, and they're so proud of them, and they love like going through the stories of what they mean, and they love finding their first Christmas tree ornaments, although Asher was born in 2010, and I bought the ornament for 2010, but it sat without a picture in it until like 2 years ago. And then my other poor children, like I think I ordered Easton's first Christmas one last year when he was four. That's the lovely thing about Etsy, is you can just change the date and they'll engrave it, and it looks like you got it when they were born.
Until they watch this video.
But the rest are just like things that we've collected over time from lots of different things. And I just ordered one this year for 2020, actually, that's a little home, and it says the year we stayed at home. And I was like, I think that's a nice little memory, you know?
Get, like a meme one. That
well, there's lots of memes. There was one that's a dumpster with fire.
Yeah, that's, I saw that one. That's a great one.
So that's a good one. Favorite Christmas movie?
I mean, it's what?
I just thought it was going to be a hands down.
Well, I think it is. I'm just pausing because if this is going to go on film, I want to make sure it's right. Elf would be my gut reaction.
Okay, I didn't think you'd say that. I thought it was between
Christmas
two.
Vacation.
Yeah, Christmas
Yeah,
Vacation.
So that's what I'm saying. It's like, but I think if I had to watch one over and over again, I would probably watch Elf.
My favorite Christmas movie, oh my gosh, this is like an impossible. It's like asking me to pick my favorite child because I watch.
I can answer that question for you.
Okay, what are you going to say?
Your favorite child. I don't know about your Christmas movie.
Stop. I do not have favorites. What do you think my favorite Christmas movie is?
Oh, I don't know.
It's like taking the Enneagram for me. I'm so indecisive, I don't even know what number I am.
I would say White Christmas. For you.
Yeah, I think
it's not
you're
really
right.
A Christmas movie.
Stop. Ryan doesn't think White Christmas is a Christmas
movie
because why?
Because it's not about Christmas. Christmas is of the, call it 2 hours. I actually don't know how the runtime is. Christmas is 5 minutes. 5 minutes. And it's only snowing for 5 minutes.
Yeah, if I had to pick one to watch over and over again, it would be White Christmas and then Home Alone 2. I know some people, I know. I love the magic of New York at Christmas time. I love New York. So somebody told me the other day that they thought 2 was terrible. And I was like,
you took it personally?
I totally took it personally. All right. Real tree or fake tree?
Real.
Real. White or rainbow or colorful lights?
White.
White. I'm a white light person too. How long should you keep Christmas lights up for after Christmas?
Well, 12:01 a.m. on Christmas morning? Well, the day after Christmas morning.
I mean, A, who wants to put that much work into decorating to just take it down? And B,
well, when you've had it up since November 1st,
well, that's true.
If you were Santa Claus, what type of cookie would you want to be left out for you on Christmas Eve?
I want a Christmas tree.
You want a Christmas tree cookie?
I want a candy cane.
I guess chocolate chip.
Okay. Would you rather go sledding, build a snowman, have a snowball fight, or stay inside and drink hot cocoa?
Snowball fight.
Snowball fight.
Yeah.
I want a snowball fight.
All of you? Nobody wants hot cocoa? The true meaning of Christmas is?
Actually, I want snow.
It's like family and friends and then Jesus being born.
Kezzy, what's your favorite Christmas song?
La 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 la.
Favorite ornament that you get to hang on the tree?
Ayla's.
Ayla's is your favorite? Sweet.
Ayla too.
You too? What's your favorite ornament?
Princess.
Princess? Yeah. When you hear the words mom and Christmas, what do you think about?
Crazy.
What do you mean by crazy? Elaborate.
You're too crazy about Christmas. You liked it too much.
Too much?
You decorated right after Halloween.
Ho, ho, ho.
Yeah. All right, guys. I hope you guys enjoyed that. We have been informed that I won.
What? No, we tied. We tied because how did you suddenly win? See, this is what I said. Did you record? Because she changed the rules.
Merry Christmas, Filthy Animal is from Home Alone 2 when he's watching the sequel in the hotel room. Keep the change, you filthy animal. Is from Home Alone 1. AC says 10%.
But you do realize that means we tied.
I think I won, but okay.
Rose-colored glasses, like her blouse or her blazer.
All right. Well, it's fun to see you guys commenting.
See what I live with every day.
Just couldn't let you get away with it, honey.
Nope.
Couldn't let you get away with it. Although I think I was reaffirming and saying that it was from both. So. You know,
you were reaffirming in public, and then when the cameras cut out, you should have seen what she did.
Okay, so we're moving on to making one of my very favorite holiday treats, which is fudge. So if you were on my celebrations tour, I think is probably when I would have told the story, but I made Christmas cookies and fudge with my mom and my sister every single year. And that's what we would give as gifts. And so we would put Christmas movies on and we would just bake. And we always made my grandma's fudge recipe. So when I was writing celebrations, I was like, I have to have a fudge recipe in the Christmas treat section.
Which grandma?
Bonnie, my grandma Bonnie, my mom's mom. And I worked so hard at trying to create the recipe, trying to make it, you know, refined sugar free and dairy free. And it just was not turning out the texture that I really grew up eating. And so I, after probably like a dozen tries, Ryan taste tested all of them.
Well, I love fudge.
I called my mom and I was like, hey, what recipe did Grandma Bonnie use? Like, what did we use when I was growing up? And she was like, oh, it's just on the back of the marshmallow fluff jar. And I was like,
Nestle Tolaus.
You got Nestle Tolaus. You've got to be kidding me. So all that to say, I finally went back to the drawing board. I realized that raw cashew butter has kind of that stretchy nature of like the jar of marshmallow fluff, nowhere near it. I don't even know what ingredients are in marshmallow fluff, but this recipe has been one now that we've been making for probably 6 years. It's one of our favorites. We both love dark chocolate. And so it's nice and rich and dark. So, all right, we're going to get started.
Cool.
That maple syrup is super full, but if you could very gingerly bring it over here and pour it into my pot, it would be, it's so full.
Live on camera. I'm really terrible at pouring things. Oh gosh, I'm nervous. Now my hands are shaking.
Okay.
Wait, we pour at the same time.
Yeah. Wait, can we get out? Ready?
Okay, ready? Three, two, one. Lady and the Tramp.
So he poured in maple syrup. I'm pouring in coconut sugar. I'll take that here. Go ahead and put it right here. Thank you.
No.
And then our coconut oil. So if you don't like this.
That doesn't look like oil.
It's coconut oil. It's just solidified because it's a little colder here, which is nice. It has to be pretty hot for coconut oil to melt down to a liquid state. But it does sometimes here during the summer. So if you don't like the flavor of coconut, which believe it or not, I do not. And I use coconut in nearly everything I make because it's a great grain-free flour and it's a great fat. But you can get refined coconut oil. It won't have the flavor and the scent of it. This is actually just virgin coconut oil. And with all the chocolate and the sweeteners, I don't really think you taste the coconut at all. And I feel like I can pick out coconut. Yes, raise your hand.
What does virgin coconut oil mean?
So it just means that it's not refined. Like it's virgin means it's like not processed.
Not been touched.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it has to be touched to actually make it into coconut oil, but like, so you, it's the type, it's just the way that they process it.
Okay.
All right. So we're going to melt that down. You don't need to use a candy thermometer, which is also the great thing about this one. Very super simple ingredients and no candy thermometer, and you don't have to babysit it. You just want the sugars to melt enough so everything is all incorporated and you're not seeing that kind of granulated texture.
What are the sugars?
The coconut, so the maple syrup and then the coconut sugar. Coconut palm crystals is another name for it sometimes that you'll see. All right. So our coconut oil, I'm going to turn this up 300, 600, 800. We want it to be somewhere around medium.
Do they go to 11?
It goes like up to like 1300 and it gets hot. All right. So Ryan, while I'm waiting for that to melt, I'm going to have you work on our raw cashew butter. So you'll notice that I'm storing this upside down. I store my nut butters and seed butters upside down because it helps the oil that's always at the top, the natural occurring oils that you do need to mix in to get the right texture.
Mm-hmm.
It helps to incorporate them. So as you set it upside down, the oil kind of starts to permeate through the butter and it actually really helps in stirring it. Do you agree? We do it with all your almond butter. I do see a little oil on the top, so just be careful when you put the spoon in there. Yeah, mix it all up. Make sure you get all the good stuff at the bottom.
Are we doing this whole thing?
No, we just need a cup. Okay. We just need a cup. Thank you. All right. Okay, I'm gonna move this up a little bit. So tonight, we're actually gonna put some crushed candy canes on top.
Festive.
You can do walnuts, you can do candy pecans, you can just leave it plain, which is what I normally do. Let's see, what else could you put on top?
Hot sauce.
Could put hot sauce. It's interesting.
Yeah, could be a new recipe.
I was going to say like goji berries because they would be really festive.
Oh, hot sauce is red.
Hot
Christmas is red.
Sauce is red. You do you, babe. All right.
We'll do me.
Okay, so that's good and melted. We've got a couple little bits of coconut oil, but that's almost done. So if you want to measure me, go ahead and measure me a cup of that. And then I'm going to put in our vanilla.
Is this here for a reason or is it just like
no, it's
decorate?
In case you need to wipe your hands.
Oh,
it was just like a, you know,
I
after like
being there.
A billion cooking videos and like cracking eggs and not having anything to wipe my hands on, I now always put a towel next to the burner because I just always feel like during our lives, I never have anything to wipe my hands on. So cashew butter, I'm going to move this so they can see it.
Yeah.
It's just this like beautifully rich.
Looks like butterscotch.
It's so good. And it's very neutral. So you can do almond butter in this. You can do sunflower seed butter. It just will have a little bit of a stronger flavor. I love cashew butter because I just feel like the flavor is very neutral. So you don't, it doesn't, you can't pick it up when you're eating it. You got it to the top, to the top. Fill her up. See, I quote things all the time.
Yes. Doesn't mean you won the game.
Fill her up, put it in your purse. Fill her up. So I'm going to put my vanilla extract in. Oh, we're bubbling. We don't want to bubble, just so you know, because that'll caramelize and crystallize your sweeteners, your sugars. So it's okay if it bubbles briefly, but definitely pull it down. What are you doing? Are you like...
I just felt like a real chef.
Yeah, uh-huh. all right, so a lot of fudge recipes have powdered sugar in it, which is just granulated sugar and some sort of a starch, sometimes corn starch.
I see salt in there too.
There's a little bit of salt. So we're using arrowroot powder instead of a corn starch and then just a teeny bit of sea salt. I feel like chocolate and salt are a match made in heaven. So that's another thing you can sprinkle on top. Like, whew. Some flaky sea salt would be really nice on top if you love that kind of salty chocolate kind of flavor. All right, I'm going to let you go ahead and pour that in. I might need to help you with this spatula because it's sticky. The other thing that about cashew butter is it's really sweet just naturally. And because we're using 100% unsweetened chocolate, we get to choose and kind of dictate the sweeteners we want in here. So a cup of maple syrup.
You see the layering I'm doing with this though?
The layering is fantastic.
If they were able to see the top down.
Fold it in.
I'm folding it in. How do you fold it in?
Just fold it in, Ryan. Okay.
You just fold.
Just fold. Sorry, guys. Schitt's Creek references.
Yeah.
If you saw our Halloween costumes, you know us, that we like it. That might be the only other thing I can quote. All right.
Yeah.
I'm going to help you here.
Yeah. Do I need to hold it with you?
No.
Okay. All right. I'm happy to let you take over if you'd like.
I'm not used to cooking with you. I'm used to cooking with the kids. And yes, I hold it with them because otherwise they'll drop
them. But I'm practically like kids, me, just like one level above.
All right. So we just want to incorporate that in and then we can put in our chocolate. So what I was saying is I know it looks like a lot on paper in terms of how much sweetener is in there, but you can taste it, but you might spit it out.
Baking chocolate?
You might go, might be elf and rub your tongue.
Is it baking chocolate?
It's totally, yeah, it's baking chocolate. 100% unsweetened chocolate. My favorite brand.
What do they backfill it with sugar?
When they make chocolate? Yeah, so a lot of time, I mean, they'll add anything from milk, like dairy cream, to make it like a milk chocolate and lots of sugar. And then typically like more a fat too, like a more of the cocoa butter. All right, so go ahead and pour our chocolate in here. I might switch to a whisk in a minute, which I thought I had out, but I think I used it for the nog. I'm actually going to go off the heat for this because we came to a boil already. And what we don't want is for our chocolate to seize, which is when you will get, it's basically when chocolate gets heated too quickly. And instead of that really nice velvety texture, you'll get kind of gritty texture. So that's why whenever you see instructions to melt chocolate, either it has you do it over a double boiler on the stove, or it'll have you do it in very short increments in the microwave. And that's why, because chocolate will seize up if it gets heated too quickly.
So
all right, go ahead.
Chocolate doesn't follow the carpe diem rule.
Wow.
Seize the day.
Wow.
If it seizes, it's a problem.
Bad dad jokes.
I'm a dad. And I don't think I'm bad.
Will you grab our readied dish over there?
Of what?
Oh, sorry. The one with the parchment paper, the glass dish.
Oh.
Okay. So you can actually kind of pick your size of pan at your own liberty here. If you want the big, huge, thick slices like you see in the photo in celebrations and like what you got on that PDF, you're going to want to go for a slightly smaller dish, something like an 8x8, 9x9.
What are we using?
That I think is it. I know. I think that's a 9x9. I've used that one before, and I just know in my eyeballs that it works really well. If you want thinner pieces, then obviously a larger kind of dish is what works best. And that goes the same for my marshmallows. I get that question a lot. Like, how do you get those big billowy marshmallows? You just don't spread it out as much. As long as you've got the marshmallow mixture the way it should be, you should be able to just spread it to however you want it and keep them as tall as you want. All right, so that is looking good. I feel like that could go on your ice cream birthday sundae that you get every year.
Yep.
Brian, we've gone, wonderful. I mean, gosh, since you were what, 12 years old? You've gone to the same restaurant and we've been together since I was 16. So I've gone for no more than half of
how old
your,
are you now? You were trying to do the math.
No, I wasn't trying to do the math.
Oh, okay.
I was trying to figure out if I've gone with you more times than you went without me, which I 100%. Think is definitely
the truth. For sure.
It was closed this year, sadly. So his dad actually drove all the way out to San Francisco and very picked up takeout for him for his birthday, which is so sweet. But he has gotten the same ice cream sundae every single birthday since I've known him and since before that. And it's just vanilla ice cream with the best chocolate fudge around. It used to be Scharfenberger chocolate, and then they stopped carrying it.
They got bought by Hershey.
Yeah. Bummer. Sad. And so now they do local Bay Area chocolate. We're in disagreement. You think it's Cho. I think it's Guittard. I don't know. We're going to have to, I'm like, if anybody works at Hillstone's restaurant, tell us, because I don't know. So I bought Cho chocolate and I made him a hot fudge. Yeah, I was just going to
do which was very
this.
Good.
Bought him a hot fudge. Sorry, I'm going to move this off camera just so we actually have some room to work here. All right. So I've lined our dish with parchment paper. That's just going to help so that we can pull the fudge straight out and then cut it on a cutting board. It will stick to your pan if you don't line it. So I definitely would recommend that.
Even the glass?
Yeah, it'll stick to glass. And you don't want to grease the pan because you'll end up having kind of like this film over.
I saw you spray something in the pan.
I did. So what that's my little trick. So I like to spray some coconut
oil.
Are you
not going to share that trick?
Well, I can share it. Thank you for bringing it up. Because it's just like an extra little thing that I sometimes do. And especially if I'm filming it, because I don't want to have to be worrying about pushing the paper down. So yeah, so some it's not really working. That's kind of the other reason why I didn't mention it. Typically, I spray a little coconut oil in the bottom of the dish, and it kind of helps the parchment paper stick to it. But quite honestly, the best thing to do is to just crease all of your edges so that they stay up on the, and I cut this one a little small, but we're fine. I mean, it's nice to have them look rustic. But yeah, it'll help your kind of help your parchment paper stick down. The other trick is I like to cut slits in your parchment at each corner of the dish. And then you kind of can like fold it like an envelope or like a paper airplane or, and that'll help it also kind of stay flush against your dish, just so you're not fighting against the parchment when you're trying to pour this lovely, yummy chocolate.
It looks great.
It does look great.
Looks very rustic.
Yeah. So I have an entire other dish of this already made and chilled because it does take about four to six hours to set up. And so I wanted to make one for you guys tonight. We'll bring that out at the end there when the kiddos come back and you guys, and we can all try it. Can you grab our,
yes.
Can you grab our candy canes over there, as Kezia calls it? What's she call it? Candy canes?
Candy
canes. And then I was going to have you crush those and I didn't think about it. So let's do that really quick.
Sure. Like a mallet?
Well, I had a better idea that was less messy. You know what? Here, hold on a minute. I'll be right back.
I'll just stand here.
You just stand there and smile. Why don't you tell them here? All right, there we go. Put them in this. Okay. This is our stasher bag. Guys, I love stasher bags. Our goal in 2020 was to try to reduce our single-use plastic. And so we've been using these here. Why don't you go like this? Or a rolling pin, whatever.
Hit it.
Hit it.
Push it.
Hit it. There.
This is for you winning.
I thought we tied.
Oh, I don't know. You were saying winning.
Maybe that's why we don't play together, because you're a sore loser. All right, so I'm going to, that's kind of right in the way there. I am going to just smooth this a little bit on the top. And then these are, they do have regular sugar in them, but they're dye-free, which is really important in our household. We don't do any artificial food coloring. And so I love these because they're actually colored with fruits and vegetables. And I'm pretty sure beets actually for this one, which I think is very fun. I want to go a little bit more fine on that because it's going to be a little hard to.
Oh, who's taking out their ingredients?
Bring in. Beat me. All week I've been saying I was going to kick your booty.
I know. That's what I heard. Heard through the grapevine that you said you were going to win.
All right. You want to help me sprinkle these?
Yes, I would love
to. All right. While we sprinkle these.
Just on top. They're not going to sink?
No, they won't sink. This stuff is nice and thick and luscious and just absolutely
that's
beautiful.
Cool.
Okay. So this stuff, I mean, I'll show it. This stuff lasts for a really long time. I actually forgot some was in my fridge and like a month later. And then I put some in the freezer last year. And it lasts, I mean, it's still just perfectly wonderful. You just pull it out, put it in the refrigerator. I will give you another tip. If for some reason you don't find yourself eating the entire thing or dropping it off at neighbors' houses right now or your elderly loved ones that you can't see, a little square in your coffee in the morning is divine.
Of the fudge? Really?
Yes.
So you put that in a marshmallow then, huh?
No, not that in a marshmallow.
Oh, I don't know.
I mean, gosh.
Sorry.
I have limits. No, but it kind of makes it like a mocha. And if you were to actually have one of this, you'd end up with like a peppermint mocha, which is absolutely
that would be really good.
Yeah. Lovely.
Would that melt, do you think, in coffee?
Yeah, it'll melt because I put it into candy canes. Yes, I have put it into hot cocoa before and it flavors it. You end up sometimes with like a little chunk at the bottom, but it gives it a nice peppermint flavor. So we'll put this in the fridge in a minute. But on to the next thing. This was so fun for us. So obviously, 2020 has been a difficult year in so many different ways. For me, in particular, not seeing my friends has been one of the harder things. I'm so thankful to be out of the hospital this year and getting more time than ever with my family. It's just been amazing. But three of my very best friends in the world live in Nashville, and that's somewhere that I would go, gosh, I mean, a handful, 5-6 times a year. Sometimes work would take me there. Sometimes Ryan would just let me go to get some good girl time and to fill out my heart. And we've gone as a family so many times. So this year, it's very special to us. And this year has been one of those years that we just can't get there and haven't been able to see my friends like so many of you for a long time. And so while we were planning this, I called one of my very best friends, Hillary, and asked if her and her family would play a game of finish that Christmas tune with us. So it was a bit chaotic.
Understatement.
Christmas chaos, mostly on our end.
Yes.
Because of our children.
I think it was all on our end.
If you ever watched Wake Up with the Walkers, it was like that, but with Zoom and Christmas songs.
And climbing on tables.
Yeah. You'll see an ice pack show up at some point.
Yeah, someone was injured in the making of the film.
But we want you guys to play along with us in the comments or whoever you're viewing with. So I'm going to give you the roles really quick, and then I want you guys to watch our fun Finish That Christmas Tune with Hillary Scott and her family. But essentially, we each got, I think, 6 songs, and it's a popular Christmas tune that starts playing. Then the tune fades out, and each family has to take turns finishing the lyrics. This was a game that we played with my friends Annie and Angie on my Come to the Table tour last year, and we didn't just do Christmas. We did everything. I mean, I was singing like Beauty and the Beast on stage, and it was so fun. So we wanted to do it tonight, and we want to invite you guys to keep your score.
Can we sing something for us when we come back on?
Putting me on the spot. I sing on there. So I have to sing to Mariah Carey. Doesn't work. Let me just also mention, I say this in the video, but my friend Hillary is a Grammy Award winning artist and songwriter, and she's got a beautiful voice. So
I think
that's very kind. All right, guys. Well, I hope you guys enjoy this. Finish this Christmas tune. Hillary Scott and our family and her kids. It's very fun. And we can't wait to see what your scores are after this. The gang's all here. As close as we're gonna get. Except for a second. I wonder if
how much fun it is to ride in a one-horse open sleigh.
Hey,
jingle bell,
okay, well,
jingle bell.
Okay.
It's a Christmas time of year.
We're gonna win them all, whatever we're doing. We're just
gonna make up our own lyrics. Okay, guys. Well, we want to say thank you for being here and that we miss you guys. And that we could be doing this in the same room as you with your Christmas tree in Nashville, but we can't. So here we are. So we love you guys so much. And I'm gonna tell the rules. So we're going to play Finish That Christmas song, which I feel like you guys have a distinct advantage because A, you are part of a Grammy winning country group and on your own as well. And you just had a Christmas album come out. I think my only advantage is that I'm slightly obsessed with Christmas, but I think you guys are gonna just take it, but that's all right because it's fun. I told my kids that whoever wins gets hot cocoa and marshmallows, but I think we'll be having hot cocoa and marshmallows no matter what because, you know, I mean, as long as they're participating. So the rules are, if we can get through this, we are going to play a snippet of a classic Christmas song, and then it's going to stop, and one member from the family has to try to finish one or two lines of the song, and then whoever gets the most
wins, and there are bonus points if you know the name of the song and the artist, which means that my family will get zero bonus points. They just made a Christmas album and released it of all songs. By the way, I was listening to it in my car. It's been on nonstop.
Oh,
love it. And I was remembering, I went and got like the Target exclusive of that album on the Swinner's Night when it came out. And I've loved it ever since. And then you guys just re-released it. I'm so excited.
We had to add some songs about our kids. Like that was, we recorded that original version before any of us were parents. And so once we all have, you know, a house full of children, we had to add to it.
Love it. Well, it's perfect for this year. I think it's something that we all needed. And the new songs especially are just so full of joy and they're so happy. And I've literally had it on since like November, whenever it came out, like before Thanksgiving, essentially, because I'm breaking all the Christmas rules. All right, well, I say we get started because we have, all of us have little ones here that might want to leave the room, which they can, but let's do it. Let's play. And if you guys want to give us a couple points to keep us up, we'll take it.
Here we go.
All right, here we go. Listen.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly, fa la 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 la. Tis the season to be jolly, fa la 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 la.
Don we now our gay apparel, fa la 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 la.
We now our gay apparel, fa la 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 la. Told the ancient Yuletide carols, fa la 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 la.
Make my wish come true.
This is a bad song for me. I'm like the highest part of the song. Thanks. Can we get extra points? Mariah Carey, All I Want for Christmas.
Oh, extra points. Hey, Ryan, you lip sync. So you lip synced? You lip synced? You were lip syncing, King, so well. I really thought you were singing for your wife.
You don't want me singing. That's the problem. I'm hopeful someone will dub over a really strong male voice in post.
Maybe I'll sleep.
Oh, I know who the writer is.
Who is it?
Dolly Parton.
Oh. I knew Dolly's voice.
It's Dolly Parton, Hard Candy Christmas, but I don't know the words.
I've never even heard the song.
I was
going
to say, that's very impressive. I'm super impressed.
Our mutual friend Annie Downs would be so disappointed in me. But Isley, you should get a point for knowing who that was.
Double points.
Get drunk.
Here comes Santa Claus, here comes Santa Claus, right down Santa Claus Lane. Fixing and blitzing and all his reindeer, pulling all the rain.
We can keep it. Oh gosh.
Hey, I'm looking to you.
I'm like, I know that song, but where did that stop? Santa knows that. So hang your stockings and say your prayers, because Santa Claus comes tonight. That's the wrong part.
I was going to say that's the wrong part.
Here comes
I don't think
Santa
we get points
Claus.
For that.
No, we don't get points for that. Oh, gosh. I don't know who said. Oh, is that Pentatonix?
I feel like it. Bells are ringing. Isn't
children
it?
Singing.
Say your prayers, cause
Santa Claus comes tonight. Say your prayers, cause Santa Claus comes tonight.
boom, 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 boom.
Oh, look at you two go.
I can do those words. Boom, boom,
boom, boom. I love it. I love it. I love down towards a leaping eight maids of milk and seven swans of swinging.
Six geese a laying, five golden rings. Four calling birds, three French hens, two turtle doves,
and a partridge in a pear tree.
By the Muppets.
12 Days of Christmas. I've never heard that one before. I love it.
Six geese a laying,
bam, bam, bam. I forgot about that part. I forgot that. Bam, bam, bam.
Another tender Tennessee. The only Christmas for me. Where the love circles around us.
Like the gifts around my tree. Oh, I know there's more snow up in Colorado than my roof will ever see.
Are you doing interpretive dance?
Yes.
But a tender Tennessee Christmas. Oh, that's going to make me cry. I want to be out there with you guys so bad. Oh.
That's a sweet one.
That really actually is going to make me cry.
So who's the artist?
Amy Grant.
Way to go, producers, with a tearjerker.
I grew up listening to that.
I love that our California family knows Tennessee Christmas.
Oh my gosh, I grew up. Well, you know, so I grew up in Colorado, so we listened to that growing up, and my family, I mean, they love Amy Grant. So yes, every year. And I don't think I'd never had been to Tennessee until I became friends with all of you guys. And now I'm like, I listen to it now, I'm like, oh my gosh.
Memories.
There's Tennessee Christmases are special.
It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. Everywhere you go, take a look at the 5 and 10. It's glistening once again. It's beginning to look a lot like Christmas.
I
know the vowel sounds. Does that count for anything? I don't know any of the actual words. I know it's croony, 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 croon, 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 croon.
Michael Bublé.
I think
it's about
candy canes, right? After where they
ended
that ended.
Candy canes
and silver lanes that glow.
Candy canes and silver lanes that glow. It's beginning.
I grew up in a Christmas obsessed family, so the only problem is sometimes I like mishear lyrics, so I wasn't sure if I actually knew the actual lyrics to things. Am I the only one playing in my family? She's singing Happy Birthday. With the dawn of what I don't know where we need to end.
Happy
Christ the Savior is born. She's singing ABCs and Happy Birthday. I can't hear. Christ the Savior is born.
Happy
Birthday. Is that Carrie Underwood? Carrie Underwood? I used to sing that song to Kezia every night, rocking her to sleep.
Rocking around the Christmas tree at the Christmas party hop.
Mistletoe hung where you can see, every couple tries to stop.
And, okay.
Love it.
Good job,
Isley. Where you can see every couple tries to stop. Rock it
up. Brenda Lee.
Who is it?
Brenda Lee.
Okay, see, I wouldn't know that. I only know because of Home Alone. It's like one of my favorites. Good job. Okay, here we go, guys.
Can you just sing the rum pum 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 part at least?
No. Go.
Something about our finest gifts we bring.
Ba-rum-pum-pum-pum.
Pum 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 pum.
We bring pum 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 pum. Who lay before the king?
I was gonna say, is that Nat King Cole? Or Bing Crosby? Okay, you were right. Hey, between
who
you and
said, Alan, who said I was bad at Christmas?
I did.
Girls in white dresses with blue satin sashes, snowflakes that stay on my nose and eyelashes, silver white winters that melt in the springs. These are a few of my favorite things.
When the dog bites, when the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad, I simply remember my favorite things, and then I don't feel so bad.
And Sound of Music.
It is from the Sound of Music.
Sound of Music, that's right. It is.
Boom.
Nice.
Well done.
When the bee stings, when I'm feeling sad, have a cup of tea, have a holly jolly Christmas, and when you walk down the street.
That's amazing.
Did you sing your song? Now I'm
saying hello to Danielle and everyone you meet.
Say hello to friends you know and everyone you meet.
Woohoo!
Lady A.
Yay!
What's the song? What's that song? I'm like, have holly jolly Christmas.
Yes.
I think we can all win. I think we all deserve hot cocoa and marshmallows.
Yes. I'm gonna go get my celebrations cookbook and get my marshmallows going. Because they're the best marshmallows in the world. They're honestly, my mom, she specifically asks for me to make them because she loves them so much.
Tell her hi.
I will.
I miss all of you. I'm going to be sending you some marshmallows in the mail. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy holidays.
Merry Christmas.
We love you guys. Thanks for doing this with us. It was a little chaotic, but that's life in our households, right? I'm like between the two of us, the six kids. Yes.
Merry Christmas!
Oh, she's giving you a kiss.
Merry Christmas! Okay, we'll talk on the phone later, hiding in the closet.
So I was going to say, I'm going to call you in silence and we can actually catch up because, like the last time, they follow me around. So, yes, the closet or the car, either one.
Love you so much.
Love you guys.
All right. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed that as much as we did.
Or didn't.
No, it was so fun.
The game was fun, but the kids were crazy.
Yeah, you know, but that's all right. I texted with Hill afterwards and she's like, we didn't even notice. Their kids were great.
We just had
fun singing. And they sang Ryan happy birthday. It was his birthday that day.
Yeah.
He was setting up all of our camera equipment. Thank goodness I have like the man that wears many hats.
Love you.
It was fun. And you guys got to hear me try to hit a Mariah. Actually, no, I didn't even try to hit a Mariah Carey note because I heard that come on and I was like, really, this is so unfair to give me this song. Who can hit that? It was a bad stopping point for that. Yes,
yeah.
But it was fun. I loved it. It was great. So I hope you guys played along and I can't wait to see your comments and how many you guys got right.
Mm-hmm.
So as we've mentioned, and as we all know, 2020 has been a really difficult year in so many different ways. But one of the things that I think Ryan and I both have been really impacted by and particularly just our hearts, you know, are for children and for so many of the kids that are suffering around our country right now with schools being out and with so many different, you know, difficulties at home. And food insecurity is higher than ever right now. And so I met up with my good friend, Ayesha Curry, and got a chance to really get to hear about what her foundation, Eat, Learn, Play, has been able to do here on the ground in the Bay Area in the last year and a half, but more than ever since March. They just really hit the ground running and have just made such a massive impact that we're so honored and excited to get to be a small part of. So with your ticket purchases, so all of us as a group, we are donating to them tonight. And Ryan and I want to match what we're donating from the tickets on our own. So we will be doing that. So I hope you guys enjoy this conversation. There's going to be a place for you to donate in addition to what we're donating if you feel called to that at the end. So enjoy this conversation with Ayesha Curry.
What? I was gonna say, or find a local one that's something similar.
That's the thing too. You know, this is local to us. I was born and mostly raised here. Ryan's lived here since he was five. And so to see the work that they're getting to do in our local community is really what we're passionate about. But I think what's more than ever just is encouraging and inspiring is seeing what they're doing for their home, for where they live. And so, you know, whether you donate or not tonight, hopefully you're inspired to really kind of dig your heels in and help with the people that are closest to you.
I was just thinking back to when I was thinking about everything, and I'm like, I think when we first met, we were both pregnant with our now 5-year-olds. Is Ryan five?
Yes.
Yes, and Easton's five, and we met at Sideboard, which I was at yesterday. And I'm like, oh my gosh, it's been forever. And I think at that point you were focusing mostly on Little Lights of Mine.
Yeah.
And since then, I mean, you've put out 2 New York Times bestselling cookbooks. You've opened restaurants. You have launched a product line. I'm like, what else? Oh, TV shows.
When you put it like that, it sounds crazy.
In 5 years, done incredible things. But I think as a friend, the most like incredible thing that I've seen you guys launch in that time, which was what, 2019? So probably like, a year and a half ago.
Yeah.
Your foundation. And I love everything that you guys with it and through it. And I think, I mean, obviously you guys just have incredible hearts. And so watching that launch and then watching everything that Eat, Learn, Play has done in that amount of time. And then of course, especially since March.
Yeah.
Is awesome.
Yeah, it's the thing that's taken the longest time to develop too, which was important to us to make sure that if we were going to do it, it wouldn't be in vain, and that we did it right, and that we were serving the community for a purpose and really trying to solve real issues.
Yeah.
And so we launched Eat, Learn, Play last July, 2019. And we had this beautiful slow rollout plan, and it was amazing. And then of course, February, March hits, and we just had to be boots on the ground, running, learning on the fly. But it's been a great experience to realize in the time of need how quickly people can come together to make things happen. And so we've been able to scale very, very quickly with the demand and the need in Oakland. And so that's been a blessing. Yeah. But it's also been a daily learning experience.
I mean, you guys doubled down and like went hard immediately. I mean, as soon as schools were announced that they were shutting down, you guys were out there on the ground, and everything that Eat, Learn, Play stands for is everything that all of a sudden was completely lacking in the Oakland area. And so I just think it's incredible how you guys just got down there put in the work. And I mean, just everything that you guys have been able to do.
I'm like you're the typical like worried, frazzled mom.
I know.
And so when I started to hear, I'll never forget it, when I started to hear whispers of this at the time, like, what is this coronavirus? Yeah. Like, what is this? And everybody was skeptical. I was one of the moms that was like stockpiling frozen meats in my freezer, and everybody thought I was crazy. And I was like, no, like we have, we need to make sure that so we had a board meeting for Eat, Learn, Play. And I brought it up and was like, hey guys, I'm sure you've heard the whispers. And everybody was like, yeah. I was like, but like, can we please have a plan in place just in case come summer, meal programs are shutting down because of the virus. And who would have thought that 2 weeks from that meeting, we wouldn't even make it to summer to have to worry about people's food programs. It was almost immediate. The need was immediate. And so yeah. I'm so happy for motherly intuition.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that was one of the things that, I mean, I know we were texting back and forth and like giving each other updates on our schools and what was happening. And I think while, you know, a lot of people are like, okay, my school's gonna shut down, what am I gonna do childcare wise? Like one of the biggest things that watching you and just seeing that was like, oh my gosh, all of these kids that depend on not only the care aspect of being in school, but the food and the meals. And so to see you guys just like get in there and work to be able to provide those meals for the kids that were missing them by being out of school was amazing. And I think I read something about like 195,000 meals that have been served by Eat Learn Play since.
I think
now
we're at 12, I think we're at 12 million meals.
Oh my gosh, yeah. Oh wait, way underestimated.
But it's insane. And the need only comes every single day, which is the unfortunate. It's great that we're able to scale, but it's also unfortunate that we have to scale because the need is growing.
Right.
But yeah, it's one of those things that three core pillars, you know, quality food, quality education and safe places to play. It's like three things that a lot of us don't think about for our children.
Right.
And a lot of parents, you know, have to think about it and they don't have access to those things. And so it's just nice to be able to be a village for the people. Everybody needs a village and some people don't have one. So it's nice to be able to step in and stand by everybody that needs a little extra help.
Yeah. So I know, I mean, when did you guys move to the Bay Area? What year?
We, oh goodness, 2009.
Okay.
So we're on 11 years now.
Yeah. Well, I was born and raised here. So just, and I think that's what, like, I loved seeing you guys come in and just, I mean, first of all, you're like the favorite adopted family to the Bay Area that's ever moved here.
We love it. We take that on wholeheartedly.
And so I just love that you zeroed in on Oakland and that you just chose to pour so much of your family and yourselves into that. What made you guys, I mean, aside from being a mom yourself, but what made you really want to kind of hone in on the children of that community?
I think for us, I can speak for both Stefan and I. When Riley was a baby, we actually lived in Oakland and we're like immersed in the community. And so I saw firsthand the need for change and for help. But outside of that, it's like when it's cyclical. So it's like when you're in a place and people want to nurture you and love you and respect you and kind of wrap their arms around you, you just want to pay it forward. And so for us, you know, moving to the Bay, we pretty much grew into our adulthood out here. And it was in Oakland that happened. And what I've found over the years is the community has always put their arms around us and treated us, like you said, like family. And so there was no second thought in our mind of where we wanted to start. Because we start where, you know, we put down our roots. And so that was really the reason why we decided to start there. The Oakland, the town, has just been so kind to us. And so we just wanted to pay it forward.
Yeah, it's amazing. So you've provided meals and jobs for so many people that lost them during this because of all of the efforts that you're doing. I know you can't say too much about it, but I know there's always something fun that happens around Christmas time. So I'm sure there's something that you guys are planning for that. But what else do you guys have planned going forward? Like, what are the next things that are to come and how can people get involved?
Yeah, so like you mentioned, we have our annual Christmas with the Currys coming up. We love doing it. It's one of our favorite times of year. Obviously this year it's going to be set up very different. And we're making sure that we follow all of the protocols and practices to make sure everyone stays safe, but still making sure that we're taking care of all the families that need help. So we're very excited about that. I can't give away too much. We're right around the corner from it though. It's happening and then obviously Christmas is right around the corner. So
I mean, your Dr. Seuss costumes and makeup last year were amazing. And I'm sure that whatever it is that you guys are planning, whatever you're able to do during this time,
yeah,
will be such a bright spot for
yes. We're hoping so. We have amazing partners and sponsors that have just made it bigger than we could have ever imagined. And so we're excited to share it with everybody in the next week or so. And then just looking at the big picture for Eat, Learn, Play, our next thing that we want to tackle, especially coming out of this pandemic, when you think about, you know, education right now, the literacy rate in Oakland, specifically with the Black and Brown community, is not great. I think we're looking at around 18% is the literacy rate in Oakland. And so our goal really is we're right now putting our heads together and figuring out ways to tackle that issue, so that we can see some change. Because when you think about it, you know, we're big on fundamentals. So that's another fundamental. If you can't read, if you can't comprehend what you're reading, nothing else really falls into place. And so along with food and along with being active, you know, having those basic literacy skills are so important in being able to you know, break the cycle and to have just a better future and a better life for the kids. And so we're figuring out ways to tackle that. We have some ideas. And so I think people will start to see a shift in that department.
Yeah, I love that. I love that. That's exciting.
Yeah.
I can't wait to hear more about it.
Yes.
Yes.
Maybe over a cup of coffee that we've also been saying we're going to
get. A cup of coffee that's just always on our calendar. I'm like, the only time I'm like, I think when we did hot yoga and went to lunch, I'm like, it's the spontaneous times that we can actually make our schedules work. But now we can't really do that because.
Yeah. And no one's doing hot yoga anywhere, so.
No, and no, yeah, no, not.
Soon,
I know, I'm like, there will be a time where we can all get together for coffees and lunches and give each other hugs again, yes. And I cannot wait.
Yes, I can't wait either.
Well, I can't wait to see, first of all, what you guys do for Christmas, because it's always exciting to see, and in the new year, and just all of the things that you guys have planned. You've already made such a massive impact, and I just think it's so encouraging for people to see and so inspirational to really plug into your community, you know? I think, I mean, it starts with home and right where you are, and I love that. So I can't wait to be able to try to be involved in more as soon as we can.
Yes, love that.
We're excited to be giving a donation to you guys, and we're really hoping that everybody that's tuning in can do the same. We provided a link for them to donate directly to you guys. So we were just really hoping that everybody can join arms with us and help you guys make the impact that you're making.
Yes, thank you so much. It means so much to us, and it's going to go a long way. So I feel like the motto is onward and upward for 2021.
Yes, agreed. Yep, it's really the only thing we can do, right? I'm like, I think that's a good way to look at it.
Yeah, for sure. No looking back.
No. Well, I can't wait to see you in person at some point. All the kids and Stefan, our love and hugs. And
I will.
We'll just keep recalendaring that dinner for when it can actually happen.
Perfect. Sounds great.
And if not, we just might have to resort to dinner on Zoom because
that could be the time too.
Of 2020, right?
That could be fun too. A little glass of wine.
Yes. I'm like, we'll make something. I've been wanting to try the Rasta pasta from your new book. You make it all the time on Instagram. We did the pineapple chicken and my kids loved it. The pasta is the next one. I'm like, okay.
Killed it when you did it. It was perfect. It made me so happy. It brought me so much joy. And I think that Rasta pasta recipe,
there's a gluten-free sub I think you do gluten-free pasta in it, right?
And yeah. Gluten-free pasta in it. And then the base is coconut milk. So I feel
I know. That's why when I saw it, I was like, ooh, that could very easily be done. So maybe we can make it together. And then we'll sit on Zoom and we'll eat.
Sounds fantastic. And I've actually been referencing your books a lot lately because I've been going dairy free lately.
You are? Oh boy.
Yeah. It's a skin thing. So
it helps. I mean, I'm telling you, I get people, well, actually my mother-in-law has some psoriasis stuff. And as soon as she went off of dairy and gluten, it like cleared up. It's crazy.
Wild.
So, I know it's not easy, but it can. It's a little bit of a hard switch, but you'll get there.
I feel better. So that's all.
Well, that's good. It's something to latch onto when you actually see the change. You're like, okay, yeah, you know, getting out the ice cream and the butter actually might be worth it. But it's
exactly
tough first.
Exactly.
All right. Well, thank you again for doing this. I love you and I miss you. And I just
I know.
Love watching everything that
we'll
you're
doing. We'll hug soon. We'll hug soon.
Yes, we will.
Okay. All right.
All right.
Bye, Danielle.
Bye.
Not wearing heels and they wouldn't show anyways.
I feel like I need to, we're now sitting and I feel like I need to stand sit up straight.
I don't know, guys. I don't know. All right. Well, hopefully you guys enjoyed that. We just love them and we love their hearts, as I mentioned in there, and just as friends and then just as being from they're the awesome. Bay Area. We love what they're doing. So we're just happy to be able to spread a small word to you guys tonight about that. So you guys have been giving us questions tonight over in the chat area. And so Ryan is going to ask me a few of those and we'll try to answer as many as we can for you guys before we head out for the night.
So since I'm reading this,
sure,
I have a question.
Okay, sure. Fire.
Why do you love me so much?
Are you serious? Did somebody ask that? Or are you just asking?
I'm asking that.
Oh, let me count the ways.
Oh, okay. Right. I'm just kidding. You don't have to answer it. Like, Dee Dee.
So many.
Actually, ways. I don't know if her full name is Dee Dee Riley or first name,
okay,
whatever. But what is a good alternative to the cashew milk due to nut allergy?
For the eggnog, probably.
So, Dee Dee? Yeah. Okay. So, actually, I'm going to group by the recipes and then we'll ask some more questions.
Great. All right. So for the cashew milk, you can use all coconut milk if you want. If you have a nut allergy completely, you can use all coconut milk. You could also do oat milk if you can tolerate some like sprouted, organic, gluten-free oats. And then otherwise, if you're just allergic to cashews, almond milk's fine as well. But yeah, I would say probably oat milk or just all coconut milk is fine. I was just trying to hide that coconut flavor. Like
and actually, Rana seems to have this a similar question,
okay,
for egg allergy.
Yep.
And then Joanna Casco says, how do you know that the yolks are fully cooked in the eggnog recipe?
Yeah, so basically they're almost going to get fully cooked just by introducing the hot liquid to them. What is happening when you're putting it back on the stove is actually thickening it. So it's almost creating like a custard base like you would for ice cream or for a pie. And so they should be fully cooked after just 30 seconds or so on there. But once you can put your spatula, like a rubber spatula through it, and it slightly coats the back of the spoon, you should be good to go.
Cool. And then, let's see, hold on. I lost my place here for a second. Jennifer wants you to remind us what the quick tip for cooling the eggnog was.
Yes. Okay. So I do this for ice cream when my kids are impatient and they want the ice cream base to like go into the ice cream maker immediately. So you just get a bowl. It's called an ice bath. Get a bowl, fill it with water, fill it with ice, put the bowl of your eggnog or the jar, whatever you've put it in, glass, into that, but don't let the water seep in because it'll water it down. And then just stir it every so often for about 15 to 20 minutes and it should chill it down. I just wouldn't suggest putting an ice cube in it because it'll water it down really bad. So do we have a visitor?
Hi, sweetie.
Hi. You were going to come in and say goodbye to everybody, but
you
can come now.
Come finish with
you
our
can
questions.
Come now.
All right.
Do you want some hot cocoa while Daddy asks me questions?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. So in terms of the butters.
Yes.
Are there any substitutes for the fudge recipe? Like, could you use regular butter? What about sunflower seed butter?
Yes. Okay. So, cashew butter has just the most mild flavor, so it's why I use it. But yes, you could do, actually, the one that would have the least flavor would be macadamia butter. But you can do almond butter, you can do sunflower seed butter. Honestly, there's so much chocolate in it, and there are, yeah, come sit with me, honey. Yep. There's so many sweeteners that it should cover it up. I've definitely heard of a lot of people doing almond butter. Yeah, you guys can have fudge and you can have marshmallows and you can have chocolate. I did tell you in the finish that tune that you guys were going to get to have hot cocoa and marshmallows. Yeah, go ahead. All right, go keep giving me questions while these guys
definitely
get there. Let me move this can. Here, honey, you can't get through.
So what will be the first thing you do after quarantine is lifted?
Sweetie. Come here. Go to Disneyland.
I'm going, I think.
It's like when they win the Super Bowl. Go to Disneyland, man. I can't wait. Yes, that would probably be the thing. I mean, if we can afford to go and we can take work off and all of that, school, go to Disneyland.
Okay.
And then go to Nashville. Sorry, that's my second.
In that order?
Maybe not. Maybe Nashville first and then Disneyland. Person. Okay.
And then Sky's asking about what the right temperature would be for the meatballs.
Daddy's iPad's there. Let's be careful with hot cocoa. Easton, how many marshmallows are you taking there, bud? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. We got to save some for our siblings because he has 3. Oh, Ash already has some. Okay. You can each take one more. Okay. So if you're using a meat thermometer to make meatballs, I think Sky's referencing somebody's question from last night about searing them first on the stove and then baking them so that you don't have to babysit them on the stovetop. A 155 or so for beef, in my opinion, is fine. In the courses, actually, we filmed something for you guys about meatballs and about doubling, tripling up and freezing them. I actually freeze them raw a lot of the times. But if you're going to be making them and then heating them in sauce later, you can go a little bit lower Kezia, there's a lot of equipment and she's crawling. Hey, sissy girl, can you stay maybe on one side just so we don't knock some of this lights? And I'm going to get hot cocoa spilled on me and you're going to get it on your iPad. But okay, how many more? Let's take a couple more questions before we all say goodnight.
When are you going to have things for men in your store? And when are the hats launching? Because I feel a little bit left out.
Yeah. Okay. So we're not sure yet about the men's thing. I love everybody that is supportive and follows my books. But just based on our statistics, about 98% of you are women. So we're not sure yet. We would love to do something that's more unisex or that, you know, can be for men and for like these two, especially. You've got chocolate all over. Awesome. And then the hats we're working on, but hopefully sometime in the early new year.
Got it. This is a great question because Kathy, I agree with you. Do you have a trick to reduce the number of dishes you use when cooking?
Oh, Kathy, no. My best.
Who does your dishes?
He's a great dish doer.
I learned it from my dad.
You did. So true. Except for I don't practice what I preach, is that you clean as you go. It really helps, but I'm not. I'm like the Tasmanian devil. I just go and go and go, and then I finish it all at the end. But if you can clean as you go, it's super helpful. In the courses, I actually did try to help you guys. Like, if there's things where you can just wipe down a bowl and use it again and not wash it, if you're going to be cooking it anyways, of course, sure, you can put a piece of fudge in your hot cocoa. Why not?
Here, use this one.
Go for it, you guys. But that's what I would say would be helpful. All right. Let's take three more.
Three more?
Because otherwise we're going to have hot cocoa.
All right. Did we start any new family traditions this year?
Did we start any new family traditions this year with quarantine and having Christmas look a little different? I can think of one that I loved on the patio.
No.
Watching Christmas movies outside.
Yes. So we got a relatively inexpensive projector that hooks up to an iPad, a screen that we strung up, and we got blankets and pillows, and we did it the first night on Thanksgiving night. We watched Jingle Jingle, by the way, guys, on Netflix. It will become a Christmas classic in our household now every year. We absolutely loved it. We watched that, and that is going to be a new tradition now. We will watch a Christmas movie out there as soon as these guys... What? It was holiday-y. It doesn't say anything about Christmas. No, you're like your dad with white Christmas. Okay, fine. Well, I liked it, and it was festive, and it felt holiday-y to me, and it snowed. But we will, as soon as the kids are off on Christmas break for school, it is my goal to watch as many movies out there as possible. We rented heaters over Thanksgiving week. We live in California, so we're a little fortunate in that way that it's not super cold, but that is a new tradition. For sure. And then you guys heard about the nutrition that was new last year. And we actually did end up sponsoring two more little girls with Ayla's exact birthday. So I would say that's a newer tradition for us as well.
Got it. And then two more questions?
Yeah, let's go. Two more.
So Alyssa asks, will the courses be all new recipes existing from cookbook or the blogs?
That's a great question. Alyssa, it's going to be a combination. There will be new ones. We're hoping to at least do one brand new recipe a month. But the other ones we've kind of selected in ones that you guys have either asked to see made that I haven't done videos on yet, or ones that lend really, really well to batch cooking, to freezing, to, yeah, like making multiples, to using in different recipes, like reusing leftovers, that kind of a thing.
Okay, so I have a question for all the kids. What's the first thing you're gonna do on Christmas morning?
We're gonna try to go out, but mom and dad said just stay downstairs.
You stay upstairs. Yeah, you're gonna try to leave your bedrooms.
I have memories of that. We woke up every morning, my sister, brother, and I, and it was always like, you can't come downstairs yet. Like, my parents were never ready for their side of the gifts yet.
And then, so, last question for you.
Just burp, can you say, excuse me.
Final question. Any surprises we can expect in 2021?
Any surprises? I mean, we just told you about the courses. I don't think there's any surprises. There's a new book coming out in 2021 that I've been working really hard on. It's not a cookbook. It's a journey, like kind of a story all about my journey of finding and loving food and being diagnosed with my disease and how we came to find that food could really be healing. So that's very exciting, but I wouldn't say that's a surprise. No. As always, we are always, always, always knocking on doors for TV shows. So we'll see. It would be a surprise to me if it happened in 2021. It would be a very lovely surprise. Is that it?
Hey guys,
come say goodbye really quick. Come here.
Kezia and Asher.
Come say goodbye. All right. Well, you might be the only one. Can you say goodbye and Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays with us? Okay. Oh, here they are. You guys say goodbye, Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays to everybody tuning in?
Goodbye, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays.
Good job.
Goodbye, Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays. Thank you guys so much again for spending your night with us. We hope that you guys love the discounts, the prizes, all of the different things, and that you guys cooked along with us and that you enjoy that fudge and that eggnog. Oh, you're got a little chocolate mustache as well.
I think we have a job to do.
He downed it. Yeah, we're gonna have a great bedtime. Great bedtime. All right, you guys. Good night, everybody. Thank you so much for being here.
I'm gonna show you my trick to cooking salmon perfectly in the oven every time. I've recreated a recipe that is dairy-free and grain-free, all made in one pot. It's my happy enchilada dance.